Totally.
Let's talk about what we know about this Richmond here in Mark 10:17. We know, number one, from Mark, it says he was very wealthy. It says he was extremely rich. Luke and Matthew use the same word. He had a lot of money. I did a lot of research on this before I started this message. I love getting into passages in the scripture and just digging into the history and things. There's nothing I could really find that actually even gave this guy a name. I mean, you want to talk about obscurity. And this is my question for you, and this is a side note, but think about this. You know, you spend all your time working, you spend all your time trying to accumulate things and make money, get money. Here's a man who was very wealthy, yet we have no idea who he is. Now, will your name, with all of your going after and getting wealth, will your name be remembered? Will it really matter? Once you're dead, will it really matter? You see, this man, based upon the culture and the time, he would have known the Torah or law because he was raised up in this culture. So when he said, "I followed these from my youth," you know, when they're really young in this Jewish culture, kids, I mean, they memorized the first five books of the Bible, the Torah, the law. They followed the Torah. They knew the Torah. They knew it. They could just, bam, knock it off. Memorization. I mean, that's what they taught these kids. And it was something, he knew the law, he knew the commandments, he knew the things that he needed to do, but he still felt there was something missing. With all of his wealth, he was not content. With all of his knowledge, he was not content. With all of his running after fulfilling the words of the law, he was not content. He knew there was something missing. You know, it's funny that when we read this story about the rich man, the first thing we do is point and say, not us. Really, you know, I love verse 23 here in Mark 10 where he says to his disciples, "How hard will it be for those who are wealthy to enter into the kingdom of God?" And the first thing we do is point, that's not me. You know, it's harder for a camel to go, or easier for a camel to go through an eye of a needle than for a rich man. Oh, that's not me. Jesus isn't talking to me.
See, isn't this a wonderful world that we live in? Yes, I made it myself. A blue sky, and of course, this table-like floor and that dinosaur. That's the entire world.
Really? Take a second here, and I want you to think about this. Let's take another side trip here. Do you own a car? Honestly, think about it. Do you own a car? Most of you probably would say yes. Well, did you know that only 8% of the world's population owns a car? So, you're in basically the 8 out of every 100 in this whole world that owns a car. 92% of the world does not have the wealth that you have right now. Because they see you driving a car and they think, there's a wealthy man. There's somebody who has money. You know, the other 92%? You know what's interesting? The United States makes up 6% of the world's population, yet we use 40% of its resources. You want to say you're not rich? There's 1 billion people in this world right now that aren't going to be able to take a drink of clean water. I mean, you could get up right now, you know, walk away from your computer, go to your faucet, turn on the water, except if you live in Oliver's. No, I'm kidding. But you could get yourself a drink of water. That's other countries, other places, people would say, wow, that's rich. You know, 800 million people today are not going to eat. Did you eat today? Are you going to eat today? Yeah, and this is the thing, and this is the one that blew my mind, and all these different facts. You can look up, check and see if I'm lying or not. That's fine with me. But the one that really blew me away was $20 billion would feed every hungry person on this world, provide them with clean drinking water and basic health necessities. $20 billion. And in 1 year, do you know how much Americans spend on ice cream? Yeah, $20 billion. I just think about that, and it's like, wow. You know, and here we sit, you know, or you sit, watching me on your computer, in the comfort of your own home, and hypocritically might say, oh, that rich guy, that's not me. You know, so if money was the problem here, then we're all screwed. I mean, that's what it comes down to. That's when Jesus is talking to this man, the question he's presenting here, he's talking to all of us. Do your things have you? Or do you just have things? Most people think, well, I have things. Well, do your things have you? Why was, you know, and this is a thing, like, why was this man rich? I mean, why? It doesn't really say in the Bible. Well, no, think about this for a second. The man followed the Torah. The man was a young ruler. The man knew the law. And the man was rich. I'm going off of just what we know from the facts listed in the Bible. Well, I know that the Bible promises in the Torah that if you go out and you're doing the things that God told you to do, and you're following His word, His law, and you're giving, you're tithing, you're doing all of these different things that are required based upon the Torah, then God promises you earthly wealth. It was a promise. This man followed the Torah from his youth. He followed the law from his youth. He followed God. And so my question is, why are we rich? You know, look at this here. Why would God make us rich? And I want to take another sidetrack here in 1 Timothy. Jump into this here. 1 Timothy, and I'm going to go into, let's see here, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17. Then I'm going to jump into something else here. But this is my question. Let me read this to you. I'm going to ask you this question. Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, or put their trust on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Instruct them to do good and to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. Instruct those who are rich in this present world, not me. Oh, really? So what does he say we need to do? What does he say? Number one, we need to not be selfish. Don't be conceited. We can't trust or put our hope or fix our hope on the uncertainty of riches or money. Money is not what you need to put your trust in. You know, and I think it's ironic that our forefathers figured that out when they put "In God We Trust" on a dollar bill to remind us this is not what we're supposed to trust in. But most people do. If something goes wrong, what's the first thing? Do I have money? Do I have money in my savings? Do I have money in my credit card? Do I have this? Do I have that? That is not God's intention. God wanted you to trust in Him and fix your hope on Him. Follow God, who richly supplies you with all good things to enjoy. God doesn't want to take your money. God doesn't want to make you poor. God doesn't want to put you in a situation to where your life just sucks because you're just, you know, living in a dirt hut somewhere in Africa. No! God wants you to be blessed, but He wants you to be blessed so you can be rich in, and the word that's used here is good works or good deeds. You know, Mark 10 said, and it said it right here that we were reading earlier, and we're going to turn back there. Mark 10. He said, anyone who's given up things for the kingdom of God will receive 100 times as much in this age. That's 29, 30, 31, all the way through there. So God doesn't have a problem with you being wealthy. It's what are you using your wealth to do? Don't expect